Okay, now we're going to talk about charge neutrality. In this case, we have a uniformly doped semiconductor, and that means charge neutrality. Therefore, there is no electric field. If we had an electric field inside our semiconductor, then there will be current, hence no equilibrium conditions. El tema neutralidad de carga habla o requiere un semiconductor que esté dopado de manera uniforme. Debido a eso, a que está dopado de manera uniforme, es que hay neutralidad de carga. Y por eso es que no hay campo eléctrico. Si hubiera campo eléctrico, pues habría corriente, ¿verdad? Entonces, pues no habría neutralidad de carga. Y eso sería debido a que no está uniformemente dopado el semiconductor, ¿ok? Eso es como el requisito, por decirlo de un modo. The equation we're going to use in this case is the sum of charges. So we have Q, which is, remember, the charge of either the electron or the hole. In the case of holes, that's why it's P, it's positive. So we have how many holes, how many electrons, how many ionized donors, positive, how many ionized acceptors, negative, and all of those must give zero for charge neutrality. Now, we can, of course, factorize Q so and leave it out of the equation. And we can only deal with numbers, how many of each. The equation with Q cancelled out is shown in the pink box. ND again represents the number of ionized donors, and NA the number of ionized acceptors. When we're working at room temperature, these numbers, ND plus and NA minus, actually become Na and Nd. So we can assume that all acceptors and all donors are ionized, meaning the fifth electron has been released and all missing bonds, all holes are free to accept those bonds that will be traveling, let's say, as bubbles inside the semiconductors. That's why in yellow we can see, and orange, sorry, that's not yellow, we can see the charge neutrality equation when we have a total ionization of dopants. That this usually happens at room temperatures. Entonces, esta ecuación que parte de la suma de cargas, podemos cancelar la Q y nos quedan solamente el número de electrones, huecos, sitios en donde hay donantes y aceptores. Y dependiendo de la temperatura, estos sitios irán aumentando. A temperatura ambiente, podemos decir que hay una total ionización, es decir, ese quinto electrón o ese espacio, ese hueco, o esos huecos y esos quintos electrones ya estarán todos disponibles para transporte. Por lo tanto, la ecuación de neutralidad de carga quedaría, o queda más bien, como se ve en la caja naranja, pero claro, debe ser igual a cero, ¿verdad? Cosa que ahí, pues, como que le faltó, ¿no? Ok. Muy bien. Esa es la Church Neutrality Equation. Y como verán, pues es una ecuación muy sencilla. That's a very simple equation, as you can see. Now, let's move on into how are we going to calculate the current concentration. Well, again, we're going to assume that we are working in non-degeneracy regime with total ionization. That means more or less room temperature. Let's say that we are given an I, the intrinsic current concentration. We can get it from tables or the internet. Na, the doping, and Nd, the doping. And when we are not given Na or Nd, we should be given at least one, we can say that the other one is so small compared to the other one that is negligible in terms of the other one being large compared to the other one. Let's say if we're just given an A, then in ND is too small. We can ignore it because it's maybe several orders of magnitude larger compared to the other one. Entonces, hablemos de cómo calculamos la concentración de portadores. Vamos a asumir que estamos en un régimen de no degeneración y con una ionización total. Seguramente nos van a, bueno, nos deben dar NI, y ya sea NA o ND o los dos. Cuando nada más nos dan uno de los valores de dopaje, NA o ND, quiere decir que el otro, el que no nos dan, es pequeño comparado con el que sí nos dan y lo podemos, por lo tanto, ignorar. Let's not forget the formula N times P equals NI square, and that therefore we can solve for P, let's say, that will be NI square over N, and that this number, sorry, this equation for P can be substituted in the charge neutrality, what we just saw, the charge neutrality equation. Of course, the same can be done in the case of N. Okay? Using the substitution that we just did, we can, let's say, multiply the whole equation times N, and we will end up with this equation, and we can rewrite it as this equation. Entonces, no olvidemos la ecuación de np igual a ni cuadrada. Despejamos p y sustituimos p en la ecuación de neutralidad de carga. Multiplicamos por n y la reordenamos y nos queda la ecuación en la cajita azul. Resolvemos esta ecuación cuadrática para n con, como se resuelven las ecuaciones cuadráticas, ¿no? Con la ecuación cuadrática. Y pues ahí está la respuesta, la de n. Si hacemos aquí el despeje de n igual a tal, 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 la, pues resolvemos, encontramos, y la resolvemos, encontramos la otra solución. Solo tomamos la raíz positiva porque, pues, n y p deben ser positivos, ¿verdad? So, we solve the equation in the blue box. It's a quadratic equation, and we get the positive root because it's the only one that makes physical sense. N and p must be positive numbers because it's the number of particles or quasi-particles. And we have n, and If in this process, instead of solving for P, we solve for N, and we do the whole thing again, we will get an equation where we can solve for P. Again, only the positive root. And that will give us the equations that can be used to solve for N and for P. Now, these equations are big, not too complicated, but they're big. So we're going to actually go into special cases. For instance, let's try it in something very simple. An intrinsic semiconductor. That means that it's not doped. So Na and Nd equals zero. When we substitute Na and Nd in the equations, these equations, we can see that everything goes away except for Ni square root. So N and P equals Ni, which we know is true, right? In an intrinsic semiconductor, that is true. Okay, let's see another special case. Let's see a special case where the difference between Nd and Na is really about the same size as Md, meaning Na is way too small. And also, Nd is much larger than Ni. Okay. We can say, we can have this case or the complementary case, which is when Na minus Nd is about the same size as Na. So Nd is way too small and Na is much larger than Ni. So in both cases, there is a quite high doping, either case one, dopants, or case two, acceptors. We're going to say that these numbers, the large ones are 10 to the 14, and Ni is about 10 to the 10, okay? So, in these cases, we can just calculate N or P with these very simple equations. Let's see why this is true. So I'm going to go back. Remember that what we just saw, Na is negligible and Nd is much larger than Ni. So let's go back. No, let's go back here. So what happened? Let's go for N. So Na was negligible. Negligible. So if you see, what we have is Nd halves and let me correct something. By the way, it's good that we did this exercise together. This is half, the whole thing is half. So please fix that. Well, so we will have the square root of this will be Nd halves. So we will have Nd, right? Which, if you notice, is Nd halves, Nd. And we can get P with the other equation. Remember that N times P equals Ni squared. So we can get P with the short formula. The same will happen if we go for the second case. So the special cases means that the big formulas can be employed, but they will simplify. Okay, what we just did can be also be done with this other example. If ND is 10 to the 15, and I is 10 to the 10 again, ND will be N, just like we saw here. And using this formula, P will be Ni squared, which is 10 to the 10 squared. This is Ni squared divided by ND, which is 10 to the 15. So that will be 10 to the 20, 10 to the 15, 10 to the 5. Of course, the units are centimeter minus 3. So this is another special case. We have a semiconductor that is doped, where the intrinsic concentration is much larger than ND minus NA. Okay? But also the temperature is large. Now, in this case, N will be equal to NA about, and it will be more or less equal to P. And what this means is that with large temperatures, semiconductors become intrinsic. And finally, we have something that is called, well, finally, about many other possible specific examples, something called a compensated semiconductor. When the difference between the subtraction, the difference between ND and NA, doesn't matter the order, is zero, but ND and NA are non-zero, so they are about the same value, we need to use the full formulas, okay? Also, when the difference between the two kind of dopings, ND and NA, the difference is about the intrinsic concentration, we also need to use the full formulas. Entonces, el segundo caso es cuando tenemos un semiconductor dopado, en donde alguno de los dos tipos de dopaje, el de los donors o el de los acceptors, es mucho más grande que el otro. Y también es mucho más grande que la concentración intrínseca. En ese caso, al sustituir en la ecuación grande, nos va a quedar que ya sea los electrones va a ser igual al número de dopantes, o los holes va a ser igual, huecos, perdón, va a ser igual al número de acceptors. Y utilizando la fórmula corta de NP es igual a NI cuadrado, pues vamos a encontrar el otro, ¿verdad? Esto aplica solo para no degenerados y ionización total. Y bueno, pues podemos hacer el ejemplo que está aquí, ¿verdad? Tenemos también otros casos, que son aquellos semiconductores dopados en donde la concentración intrínseca es mucho mayor que la diferencia entre los dos tipos de dopaje y la temperatura es muy alta. En ese caso, la concentración de huecos y electrones es muy parecida entre entre ella y también con la concentración intrínseca. Esto siempre va a pasar a altas temperaturas y eso es debido a que, bueno, y esto tiene como consecuencia que los semiconductores se conviertan en intrínsecos a temperaturas altas. Es un motivo por el que no queremos que nuestros semiconductores, nuestros chips, digamos, nuestros aparatos operen, o bueno, más bien, se calienten, porque entonces dejan de ser semiconductores como los queremos que funcionen. Y también un tipo que se llama compensados, que son cuando la diferencia entre ellos es cero, aunque el valor de los de ellos, me refiero a los dopajes, sea cero, aunque los dopajes no sean cero. O cuando la diferencia entre los dopajes sea más o menos igual a la concentración intrínseca. En ambos casos hay que usar las fórmulas completas. Vamos a resolver el ejercicio 2.5. Tenemos una muestra de silicio que se dopa 10 a la, con 10 a la 14 átomos de boro por centímetro cúbico. Y nos piden que encontremos los valores de N y de P a 300 Kelvin y de N y de P a 470 Kelvin. Entonces, bueno, sabemos que, primero tenemos que saber que el boro es un dopante de tipo acceptor. Entonces, por eso es que es Na y es 10 a la 14, centímetros a la menos 3. ¿Ok? Tenemos que conocer la concentración intrínseca del silicio a 300. Para eso usamos la figura 220. Entonces, vamos a abrir la figura 220, que yo la tengo por aquí. Y ustedes la tienen en alguna de sus tareas. Pero déjenme la encuentro porque la tenía abierta, pero me puse a firmar algunos documentos y ya no la tengo abierta, pero aquí está. Esta es la figura 220. Aquí está este eje es en este eje, perdón, es NI y este eje es la temperatura en Kelvin. ¿Sale? Entonces, nos piden la concentración intrínseca del silicio a 300. Esa es una escala logarítmica que espero que la sepan leer. Entonces, bueno, esto es 300, esta raya, esta. Entonces, pues nada más hay que seguirla, ¿no? Aquí está 300. Esta, la segunda es silicio, ¿ya vieron? Este es silicio. Entonces, obviamente aquí está que la concentración intrínseca es 10 a la 10. So, this is figure 220 is in your homework. This is the book, textbook, the Pierret book. Temperature is in the x-axis. Intrinsic concentration Ni is in the y-axis. The germanium graph is, well, the first graph is germanium, silicon, and gallium arsenide. We want the one in the middle. So we want 300 Kelvin, and Ni happens to be 10 to the 10, right? So we go back to our document, and indeed, Ni is correct, is 1 times 10 to the 10 at 300 Kelvin. And we happen to be in a regime where Ni is much larger than ND. But why is that? Because ND is not given. So we can assume that ND is small, it's way small compared to Na. Entonces, ya sabemos que el boro es un acceptor, lo tenemos que saber, ¿eh? Y nos dicen que es 10 a la 14. Ni lo acabamos de sacar de la tabla, a 300 Kelvin. Y como no nos dan ND, asumimos que es pequeño, muy pequeño de hecho, comparado con Na. Por lo tanto, el número de holes, porque es acceptor, va a ser igual a Na y 10 a la 14. ¿Ok? Y como ya tenemos P. Y para N usamos la formulita esta. Y pues hacemos ni cuadrada, o sea, hace esto al cuadrado, que es 10 a la 20, y p, que la acabamos de sacar, que es 10 a la 14, y nos da 10 a la 6. So, with these values known, we can know that p equals na, we are in that regime, na greater than nd, and na greater than ni as well, right? So, p equals 10 to the 14, and using this formula is 10 to the 20, 10 to the 14, 10 to the 6, and we're done. Now, for part B, we need to do exactly the same, but we need Ni at 470 Kelvin. So, we go to the table again, and we find 470. So, remember that this is 500. Okay, let's make this smaller. 500, 90, 80, 70. Okay? So it's the. If this is the first, second, third, the fourth line, considering the strong line to be the first. Okay. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's 10 to the 14 for silicon. Okay? For a temperature of 470, right? Remember, 500, 490, 480, 470. 5, 9, 8, 7. 10 to the 14, that's Ni. Here it is, here is Ni. And then, because of that, I know that Ni is about the same value for the doping. We know that the doping is doped with 10 to the 14 for an atom. So that Ni is about the same value of the, and I is the same value of an NA acceptors. So in those cases, we were told, and remember that ND in this example is negligible, so about zero, let's say, even though we don't know, but it's negligible. So we need to use full formulas. So this is the full formula for P. Why P? Because we know NA, we don't know ND. So we use NA, 10 to the 14 over 2, N to the 14 square over 2, NI square, calculator. Here it is, then the formula for N. And these are the values for N and P, over P and N in that order, using the full formulas, which is not such a big problem, really. Okay? And that's it. Now, you might wonder what are the full formulas, because I don't know them, of course. Oh, yeah, where is ND? Well, we said that ND is small and it's about zero. That's why ND does not appear in the P, in this P formula. ND is about zero. Okay? It's not that it's zero really. ND is probably 10 to the 10 maybe. But it's a subtraction, right? So what you will be doing more or less, well, it's not more or less really, is that you are doing 10 to the 14, pardon me, 10 to the 14 minus 10 to the 10. So imagine that that is something like that minus 1. So that is about that quantity. That is exactly this number. But you see that the difference is negligible, okay? 10,000 is about the same as 9,999. Okay? Entonces, en 470, buscamos NI en la tabla y nos dimos cuenta que es 10 a la 14, que es lo mismo que el dopaje de boro. Por lo tanto, usamos las ecuaciones completas, que ahí están. Solo que ND lo descartamos porque, aunque no es cero, claro, ya sabemos que 10 a la 14, que es NA menos ND, que sería 10 a la 10, más o menos, pues es ridículamente... la resta, pues, es de chocolate. Eso no lo dije en inglés, ¿verdad? Entonces, pues, no es relevante. Por eso es que ND tiende a cero en este caso, ¿no? Y por eso es que la podemos ignorar. Y hecho eso, pues, usamos la fórmula cuasi completa. Y, y pues, ya. Con eso obtenemos N y obtenemos P. Y con eso de ahí... Creo que lo vamos a dejar ahí. Gracias.